Now we would be having the question and answer session. To derive more benefit for all of those present here, in the limited time that we have available, we would like the following rules to be observed. Your questions asked should be on the topic of the day, Quran and modern science, conflict or conciliation only. Questions not relevant to the topic will not be entertained. Kindly state your questions briefly and to the point. This is question answer time and not lecture time. Only one question at a time will be permitted. For your second question, you would have to go behind the row and await your second chance. We have three mics provided on the ground, two on my sides, right side one, left side one. These are for the gents. And we have one behind in the center in the ladies section for the ladies. I am told there are people watching this program in the Alma Latifi Hall, which is full on the video screen. I would request those brothers, if they have any questions, to kindly come down in the ground. The volunteers present at your end would assist you in it. We will allow only one question on each of the mics in clockwise rotation. First, the ladies, second, the gent on my right, third, the gents on my left, and so on in clockwise manner. Written questions on papers or slips which are available from our volunteers in the aisles would be given secondary preference after the open questions on the mics are answered by Dr. Zakir. In the interest of having a less time-wasting, a more educative and an interesting question and answer session, our decision to allow or disallow irrelevant questions will be final. In the interest of eliciting a proper and clear answer from the speaker, kindly state your name and profession before putting forward your question so his answer can be more appropriate to your understanding. May we have the first question from the ladies section?
Assalamu alaikum. I am Kausar Sheikh, a product of Darul Quran, Kuwait. Presently, I am teaching Arabic in Anushakti Nagar. My question is, it is mentioned in the Quran that one day in the sight of Allah is equal to 1,000 years. And in another place, it is mentioned that one day is equal to 50,000 years. Isn't the Quran contradicting itself? Please explain.
The sister asked a question that it's mentioned in the Quran in certain place that one day in the sight of Allah is equal to 1,000 years, and somewhere else it's mentioned that one day in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is equal to 50,000 years. Isn't this a contradiction? What the sister was referring to is the verse of the Holy Quran from Surah Al-Hajj, chapter 22. Verse number 47, as well as Surah Sajda, chapter 32, verse number 5, which does say that one day in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is equal to 1,000 years. And in Surah Maarij, chapter 70, verse number 4, it says that one day in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is equal to 50,000 years of your reckoning. Doesn't it seem to be a contradiction? Sister, what these verses in the Holy Quran are referring to, it is giving an indication that time in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is incomparable to the earthly time. The earthly time, whether it's 1,000 years or whether it's 50,000 years or whether it's thousands of years, It's somewhat equal to one day in the sight of Allah, or maybe 1 second in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's just giving you a reference that time in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is incomparable to the earthly time. But even if you want to take these verses literally, still there's an explanation for that. The Arabic word used in these verses is yawm. It has got two different meanings. It can either be translated as day or as period or as epoch, very long period. So if you read this verse of Surah Sajda, chapter 32, verse number 5, it says, it is Allah who rules the affairs from the heavens to the earth. And all these go up to him on a day, which is equal to 1,000 years of reckoning. If you translate the word correctly, yom, as period, it will read that Allah rules all the affairs from the heavens to the earth, and all of them go unto him in a period which is equal to 1,000 years of your reckoning. Surah Ma'arij chapter 70, verse number 4 reads that the spirits and the angels, they ascend unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a day which is equal to 50,000 years of your reckoning. If you translate it correctly, yom as period, it will read that the spirits and the angels ascend unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a period equal to 50,000 years. The Quran is referring to two different periods. Therefore, there's no contradiction. For example, if I say, I will take 1 hour to reach Washi, I will take a period of 1 hour to reach Washi, and then say, I will take a period of 50 hours to reach Srinagar, to reach Kashmir. It's not contradicting, because both are different periods. So one place Quran says, the period required for all the spirits and the angels to go up unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is equal to 50,000 years of your reckoning. And the other place says, the period required for all the affairs to go unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is 1,000 years. There's no contradiction in that. I hope that answers the question.
Assalamu alaikum, Zakir bhai. My name is Shakir and I'm a mechanical engineer student. I would like to ask you a question that how can you prove to an atheist scientifically the existence of God?
The brother has posed the question, how can you scientifically prove the existence of God Almighty, the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially to an atheist who does not believe in God? The first thing I will do is that I will congratulate that atheist. I'll congratulate him. You know why? If you look around us, he's a Hindu because father is a Hindu. He's a Christian because father is a Christian. Some Muslims are Muslim because their fathers are Muslim. This person, though he may be coming from a religious background, he does not believe in the false God which his parents attribute to. So he does not believe in God. I'm congratulating him because he's accepted the first part of the Shahada, the first part of the Islamic creed, La ilaha, there is no God. Now my job is to prove illallah, but Allah, which I shall do inshallah. To the other people, I have to first remove the wrong concept of God and then prove the right concept of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here half my job is done. He has already said La ilaha. There's no God. Now I have to prove illallah, but Allah, which I shall do inshallah. You ask this atheist that suppose there is an object, an unidentified, maybe a flying object, which no one in the world has seen. No human being in the world knows about this object. If it's brought in front of you, and if you're asked that who will be the first person who will be able to tell you the mechanism of this unidentified object, you have to ask him the question. Who is the first person who will be able to tell you the mechanism of this new object which no one in the world has seen? After thinking for a while, he'll give the answer. The person who will be able to tell you the mechanism, the first person, is the creator of that object. Some may say manufacturer, some may say producer. Whatever they say, don't grapple with the word, accept it. It will be somewhat similar. Either creator or producer, or manufacturer, but remember what he has told you. Keep it in your mind. Then ask him the next question. How did the universe come into existence? How was it formed? He will tell you by the Big Bang Theory. Tell him, the Quran mentions in Surah Anbiya, chapter 21, verse number 30, about the Big Bang Theory. Who could have mentioned this in the Quran 1400 years ago? So he will tell you, maybe it's a fluke. Don't argue with him. Next part of the question. We did not know that the light of the moon is reflected light. We came to know recently. You ask him, he'll tell you, yes, yes. The light of the moon is reflected light. It's not its own light. When we discovered, he will tell you recently, yesterday, 50 years back, 100 years back, yesterday in science. You tell him, the Quran mentioned that the light of the moon is reflected light 1400 years ago. Who could have mentioned that? Maybe somebody had a wild guess. Don't argue with him. Continue. We thought the sun was stationary. You ask him, is it stationary? He'll say, no. It's rotating and revolving. When you learn this, he will tell you yesterday, 50 years back, 20 years back. Quran mentioned this 1400 years ago. He will hesitate, but may say, maybe some intelligent person wrote it. Don't argue with him. Continue. How was the universe initially? What is celestial matter? He will tell you, it was smoke. How did you come to know? We have got proof, we have got evidence. You tell him, Quran mentioned this 1400 years ago. Who could have mentioned that? He will hesitate. Don't wait for response. Continue. Keep on posing question after question. All that I give in the lecture, keep on posing one question after the other. That, what a cycle. How do we come to know about it? Quran mentioned 1400 years ago. About every living thing made from water. Who could have mentioned that? Quran speaks about botany, the male and female. Who could have mentioned that? Pose one after the other and ask the question, who could have written that? Then you tell him that there's a theory known as theory of probability. That if you have two choices, out of which one is right, the chances that you will make the correct choice, just at random, is 1 in 2. For example, if I toss a coin, it can either be heads or tails. The chances that I'll be right will be 1 in 2. If I toss it twice, the chances that I'll be right both the times will be 1/2 multiplied by 1/2, that is 1/4, 25% chance. If I toss it thrice, chances I'll be right all three times, 1/2 multiplied by 1/2 multiplied by 1/2, it's 1/8, 12.5%. A dice has got 6 sides. If I throw a dice, the chances that at random I'll be correct is 1/6. If I throw it twice, the chances that both the time I'll be right will be 1/6 by 1/6, 1/36. This is called as theory of probability. If I throw the dice twice and then toss a coin, all three being right will be 1/6 by 1/6 by 1/2, is 1/72. So you ask him, the chances may be, if you ask, what is the shape of the earth? There are various shapes. Some may say it is flat, some may say it's triangular, some may say it is hexagonal, some may say pentagonal, some may say heptagonal, some may say square. Say there can be 10 shapes. Some may say it is round, it is spherical. The chances that if anyone makes a wild guess, it being correct, is 1/10. The light of the moon, it can either be its own light or it can be reflected light. The chances that you make a wild guess and it being correct will be 1/2. The chances that both shape of the earth and light of the moon being reflected light, both being correct, if you make a wild guess, it will be 1/10 multiplied by 1/2, it is 1/20. What can the living creatures be made of? Some may say sand, some may say stone, some may say aluminium, some may say gold. Say 1,000 materials you can name. Some may say water, some may say silver, 1,000 materials. The chances that you make a wild guess, and one of them being right, according to mathematics, is 1/1,000. The chances that all three being correct, the earth is spherical, light of the moon is reflected light, and every living creature created from water is correct, will be 1/10, multiplied by 1/2, multiplied by 1/1,000. Answer comes to 1/20,000. or 0.005%. Quran speaks about scientific science more than 1,000 verses. In 3 verses, the chance comes to 0.05%. If you apply probability theory to all this being at random chance, it will come to zero, negligible. And in maths, anything 1 in 10 raised to 50, it's equal to zero. So you ask your atheist friend, who could have written this? The only answer he can give you is this first answer, the creator, the manufacturer, the person who has produced it. That's the only answer. There's no other answer. What science is saying today is they are not eliminating God. They are eliminating models of God. La ilaha illallah. They are not eliminating God, but models of God. I hope that answers the question.
My name is Javed, and I'm a student. I would like to ask a question. At one place, the Holy Quran states that man is created from sperm, which is inconsistent with modern science. But at another place, it also states that man is made from dust. Now, isn't the Holy Quran contradicting itself, or is it consistent with modern science?
The brother posed the question that one place the Holy Quran says that human beings have been created from sperm, which consists of modern science. The other place, human beings are created from dust. Can you prove it scientifically it's created from dust? And isn't there a contradiction? One place sperm, one place it says dust. The Holy Quran does say, as I mentioned in my talk, in Surah Qiyamah, chapter 75, verse number 37 to 39, it says that human beings have been created from sperm, which has been proved by science. The Holy Quran also says in Surah Hajj, chapter 22, verse number 5, that we have created the human beings from a quintessence of dust. Today, science tells us that all the elements that are there in the human body, they are present in lesser or greater quantity in the soil, in the earth. So the statement that human beings have been created from earth is scientifically proven. That whatever components are there in the human body, the constituent, the elements, they are present in the earth, in the soil, in lesser or greater proportion. The second part of the question, isn't it a contradiction? One place the Quran says man is created from sperm, one says from dust. Is it a contradiction? See, a contradiction is two statements which are conflicting with each other, which cannot take place simultaneously. The Quran does not only say man has been created from sperm and the other place from dust. It also says in Surah Furqan, chapter 25, verse 54, that man has been created from water. You will tell me that three contradictions. See, science has proven that man has been created from dust, as well as from sperm, as well as from water. If I tell you, in one statement, that to make a cup of tea, I require water. In the second statement, I say, to make a cup of tea, I require tea leaves or tea powder. It's not a contradiction. I require both. If I want to make sweet tea, I add sugar to it. If I want to make Panicum tea, I add less water and more milk. If I want to make Soleimani tea, I add only water. So there is no contradiction when the Quran says human being is created from sperm and dust and water. It is actually contradistinction. What is the meaning of contradistinction? Contradistinction means speaking two or more things about a subject which are not conflicting with each other. For example, if I say that this man, he's honest, he's kind and loving, it is contradistinction. But if I say this man is always a liar and a truthful person, then it's contradiction, because both are opposing. If it's not opposing, it's called as contradistinction.
A Next question from the ladies section.
Assalamu alaikum, brother. My name is Farida Ansari. I am a laboratory technician. Quran says, Allah is the creator of the human being. Does science agree with it?
The sister posed a question that the Quran mentions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of the human beings. Does science agree with it? And Quran says in several places, including the last verse of the embryological stages, that is Surah Mu'minun, chapter 23, verse number 14, that Allah is the best to create. Can we prove it scientifically that Allah is the creator? Quran gives the answer. Quran gives the answer in Surah Tur, chapter 52, verse number 35. It poses a question that, were you created from nothing? See, the Arabic word used for creator in all the verses of the Quran is khaliq. It derives from the Arabic word khalaqa. Arabic word khalaqa has got four meanings. One meaning is to create something from nothing without any previous example. That's only possible for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Second meaning of khalaqa is to create something new from pre-existing material. The third meaning is of khalaqa, programming or planning. And the last meaning is to make smooth. So Quran poses a question in Surah Tur, chapter 52, verse 35, that were you created from nothing? But naturally the answer is negative. No, human beings aren't created from nothing. They pose the next question. Were you the creators or we the creators? We know very well that man cannot create another man. If he could do that, then the moment he died, he would have created himself back. If his relatives would have died, he would have brought them back to life. Human beings can't even create a living creature such as fly, leave aside human being. Neither can you attribute the organs of the body, say the reproductive organs, like testes or ovaries, that they are the cause for a creation. Because if you say that, the testes, the uterus, etc., are the cause, then you have to include your ancestors, their reproductive system, their ancestors, all are responsible. So the answer is negative. Quran poses the next question in Surah Waqia, chapter 56, verse number 58 and 59, that do you not look at the sperm you have emitted? Were you the creator or we the creator? And but naturally, all these questions that Quran poses, the answer is negative. Some people can say it's by chance. By chance we were created. They say nature, natural thing. It happened by chance. Let's analyze scientifically whether the human beings can be created by chance. The protein molecule is a very important structure of the living cell. Very important part in the living structure of the cell. The protein molecule consists of five elements: the carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, hydrogen, and sulfur. And there are tens and thousands of atoms required to make one molecule. One atom has five elements: carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, hydrogen, and sulfur. There are tens of thousands of atoms which make one protein molecule. And there are approximately 92 free elements. The chances that out of these 92, the five will form an atom, and these atoms will form tens and thousands of atoms to form one protein molecule, was calculated by Frank Alien. And he said the chances are 1 in 10 raised to 160. You know what is the meaning of 1 in 10 raised to 160? If I say 1 in 10 raised to 2, 10 raised to 2 means 100, two zeros. 1 in 100. Chances is 1%. If I say 1 in 10 raised to 3, it means 1 in 1,000. That's 0.1%. If I say 1 in 10 raised to 4, it means 1 in 10,000. Means 0.01%. So when the calculation was made, 1 in 10 raised to 160, it means 0.00000157 zeros, then 1. And mathematics tells anything 1 in raised to 10 raised to 50, it's counted as 0. Furthermore,
This is talking about one molecule, and the substance required to form this one molecule of protein was calculated by another person, Charles Guy. That it will require millions of times of substance as huge as our galaxies. Millions of galaxies will require to form this one molecule of protein. And the time was calculated by Charles Guy. The time taken for one protein molecule to be formed will be 10 raised to 263 years. You know what is that? 1000000, 263 zeros it will take to form one protein molecule. And do you know there are how many protein molecules in one cell? And do you know how many other molecules are there in the cell? And how many cells are there in the human being? There are more than 6 billion molecules when a child is born. That's what doctors tell us today. 6 billion. One protein molecule takes 1 in 10 raised to 160 chances. Time taken is 10 raised to 243 years. To take 6 billion for one baby, imagine. And how many women are pregnant? There are millions of women pregnant at a time. And it takes only 9 months. The chances science tells us is 0, 0, 0. No chance at all. These things cannot take by chance. They have to be programmed by someone. Science tells us there has to be someone, some supernatural force. Therefore, science, as I said earlier, is not eliminating God, it is eliminating models of God. La ilaha illallah. Hope that answers the question.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Ashfaq and I'm a student. My question is, Quran in several places has mentioned that the heavens and the earth were created in 6 days. But in Surah Fussilat, it says the heaven and the earth was created in 8 days. Isn't this a contradiction? And the same verse also says that the earth was created in 6 days and then later on the heaven in 2 days. This is against the Big Bang theory that the heavens and earth were created simultaneously.
Well, that posed a very important question. The Quran says the heavens and the earth were created in 6 days. When Surah Fussilat, it says 8 days. Isn't there a contradiction and also contradiction with the Big Bang theory? I do agree with you, brother. The Quran says in several places that the heavens and the earth were created in 6 days. In several places. In Surah Araf, chapter 7, verse number 54. In Surah Yunus, chapter 10, verse number 3. In Surah Hud, chapter 11, verse number 7. In Surah Furqan, chapter 25, verse number 59. In Surah Sajda, chapter 32, verse number 4. In Surah Hadith, chapter 57, verse number 4. In several places, the Quran says the heavens and the earth were created in 6 days. It's not the earthly days. It is ayams, very long periods, which scientists have got no objection to. And I also agree with you that the Quran does speak about the creation of the heavens and the earth in Surah Fussilat. The verse you are referring to, brother, is verses 9 to 12, which says that, do you not believe in the one who has created the earth in 2 days? And do you join equals with him? Do you join partners with him who is the Lord of the worlds? Verse number 10 says, he has set on the earth mountains standing firm and given due nourishment on the earth in 4 days. Verse number 11 says, moreover, in his design he comprehended the sky when it was smoke, and he said to it and the earth, come ye together willingly or unwillingly? And they said, we come together in willing obedience. This he did in 2 days. So if you read it just without thinking, 2 + 4 + 2 = 8 days. Quran gives the answer in the starting of the verse, that it says that all those who will take out this fault, they are equal to those people who will join partners to God. Means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew that there will be people who will take out fault in the Quran in this verse. They will be the mushriks. And today, this verse is commonly used by the Christian missionaries against the Muslims. If you go around, I've been traveling the world, this question was posed to me even there. The Christian missionaries, they pose this question. Quran says, it predicts that people will ask about this question, and these people will be those who are associate partners with God. Let's analyze. The first two verses, that is Surah Fusilat, chapter 41, verse 9 and 10, says that the earth was created in 2 days, and then mountains were set on it, and nourishment was given in due proportion in 4 days. So it says, 2 days the earth was formed, mountains were set on it afterwards, in 4 days, total comes to 6 days. Then verse number 11 starts with the Arabic word summa. Now the Arabic word summa can be translated in 3 different ways. One is then, one is moreover, and the other is simultaneously. I do know that many translations have translated the Arabic word summa as then. If you translate summa as then there is a contradiction. It says then the heavens were made in 2 days. That means 2 + 4 + 2 is equal to 8 days. But the exact translation should be, summa should be translated as moreover or simultaneously. And Abdullah Yusuf Ali, alhamdulillah, in this place has translated summa correctly as moreover. So if you translate summa as moreover or simultaneously, it will mean that when the earth and the mountains were created in 6 days, simultaneously the heavens were created in 2 days. For example, suppose a builder, he gives in his brochure that I have constructed a 10-story building along with its surrounding and compound wall in 6 months. When a person wants to buy a flat in that building, he goes to the builder and he asks for more detail. So the builder says, it took me 2 months to make the basement of the building and another 4 months to make the 10-story. And while I was building the basement and the story, I simultaneously built the compound wall and the surrounding in 2 months. It's possible. So then he's not contradicting. Total comes to, yes, 6 months. So similarly, when Surah Fusilat chapter 41, verse number 9 to 12, it says that while the earth was created along with the mountain in 6 days, simultaneously the heavens was created in 2 days. There's no contradiction. And similarly, if you take then, it contradicts with science, because earth was created first, then were created the mountains. It's contradicting. Similarly, Quran speaks in Surah Baqarah, chapter 2, verse 29, that Allah made the earth, summa the heavens. But unfortunately here, Abdullah Yusuf Ali has translated summa wrongly as then. In verse 29 of Surah Baqarah, chapter 2, he translates summa as then. Allah created the earth and then the heaven. Then there's a contradiction. Even here, summa should be translated as moreover or simultaneously. If it's translated simultaneously, then it's not a contradiction, because the Big Bang theory tells us that the earth and the heavens were created simultaneously. No wonder in the Quran, the Quran says in many places, we created the heavens and the earth. In other places it says, we created the earth and the heavens. Giving evidence to the verse of the Quran of Surah Al-Anbiya, chapter 21, verse number 30, it says, أَوَلَمْ يَرَى الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَنَّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ كَانَ تَرَتْكَنْ فَتَقْنَهُمَا. That do not the unbelievers see that the heavens and the earth were joined together and we clove them asunder.
Assalamu alaikum. I am Ghulam Muhammad. I appreciate your explanation about the bisexual reproduction in animals. And my question is, can you support this change of sexes in animals and plants with the change of nutrient and environment with the chronic versions, and also the production of fruits without fertilization?
That's right. Brother has asked a very good question.
Thank you.
He's asked a question that scientifically can you prove that there are certain plants he mentioned. And I can mention more few also, bananas and papaya, the bisexual plants. So if you heard in my talk, brother, I made a statement that even the bisexual plants, they have got distinct characteristics of male and female. Regarding the question of fruits, if you analyze, the fruit is the product of reproduction, is the end product of reproduction of superior plants. The stage before fruit is the stage of flower. The flowers have got both, male and female, stamen and ovules. Only after the pollen comes there do you get fruit, and then the fruit gives off seed, etc. These are known as parthenocarpic fruits. Even in these, there's distinct characteristic of male and female, and the Quran rightly says in Surah Ra, chapter 13, verse number 3, that we have created fruits in pairs, in twos and twos. Hope that answers the question.
I'm Farzana Mullah. My question is, with regard to the evolution of Homo sapiens, you have Charles Darwin in Science giving an explanation that it's because of the process of natural selection that the human beings have evolved. Now, this is, seems to be in contradiction with the Islamic belief that we are the children of Adam alayhi salam. Now, how can this be reconciled?
This is a very important question. No lecture of mine on this topic of Quran modern science is complete without this question. I've given this talk in various places, in Canada, in USA, in UK, in Saudi. Never is this topic complete, never is the question answer complete without this important question of theory of evolution. Charles Darwin, sister has posed the question, how can you reconcile the Quran with Darwin's theory of evolution? Sister, I have not come across any book which says fact of evolution. All the books say theory of evolution. There's no book I've come across saying fact of evolution. If you read the book by Charles Darwin, The Origin of Species, it says that Charles Darwin went on an island by the name of Calatropis on a ship named as HMS Beagle. And there he found birds pecking at niches. Depending upon the ecological niches they pecked, the beaks, kept on becoming long and short. This observation was made in the same species, not in different species. Charles Darwin wrote a letter to his friend Thomas Thornton in 1861 saying, I do not believe in natural selection, the word that you used. I don't believe in theory of evolution because I've got any proof. I only believe in it because it helps me in classification of embryology, in morphology, in rudimentary organs. Charles Darwin himself said that there were missing links. He didn't agree with it. He himself said that there were missing links. Therefore, if I have to insult someone, that if you were present at Darwin's time, this theory would have been proved right, trying to insinuate that he looks like an ape. It's a joke we make. The reason that this theory, in most parts of the world, it is taught as good as fact. You know why? Even I was in school, I learned about Darwin's theory. And even today they are taught. You know what the reason is, sister? The reason is because that if you analyze the church was against science previously. And you know the incidents that they sentenced Galileo to death. They sentenced Galileo to death. Why? Because he said certain statements in astronomy, etc., which went against the Bible, so they sentenced him to death, for which the Pope apologized now. So when Charles Darwin came up with a theory which goes against the Bible, they didn't want any sufficient proof. An enemy of my enemy is my friend. So all the scientists, most of them, they support the theory because it went against the Bible, not because it was true. They only supported it because it went against the Bible. All the stages you have mentioned, sister, all the stages, Lucy, there were four hominoids. Science tells us today there's four hominoids. First is Lucy, along with its guide, the Australopithecus, which died about 3.5 million years, Ice Age. Then next came the Homo sapiens, who died about 500,000 years ago. Then came the Neanderthal man, who died 100 to 40,000 years ago. Then came the fourth stage, the Cro-Magnon. There is no link at all between these stages. According to P.P. Grasse, in 1971, who held the chair of evolutionary studies in Paris, in the Sorbonne University, he said, it is absurd. We cannot say who are ancestors based on fossils. I can give you a list of hundreds of scientists and Nobel Prize winners who speak against Darwin's theory. Hundreds. If you know of Sir Albert Georgi, who got the Nobel Prize for inventing the vitamin C, he wrote a book, The Crazy Ape and Man, against Darwin's theory. Again, if you read Sir Fred Hoyle's works, he wrote several works against Darwin's theory. If you know about Rupert Talbot, this person wrote a new theory of evolution against Darwin's theory. It's unthinkable. We cannot think that we are created from the apes. If you know of Sir Frank Salisbury, you are the biologist. He said it is illogical to believe in Darwin's theory. If you know about white meat, Sir White Meat, he wrote a book against Darwin's theory. He was also a biologist. Several, you can give a list of hundreds. Today it is taught in the schools. Why? I told you. Media is in their hands. Otherwise, there's no proof at all. There are certain proofs at lower levels. An amoeba at lower species level, amoeba can change to paramecia. Quran does not say amoeba cannot change to paramecia. Quran does not say. If they have got proof, can be possible. It's not against the Quran. But there's no proof at all. People talk about molecular biology theory. They talk about genetic coding. According to Hans Craig, who's authority in this field, he said it is unimaginable. Again, if you do that ratio, the probability of one DNA forming from ape to human being is again zero. If I start calculating, I think we'll get bored again. You know the calculation I told you for one protein molecule? It is somewhat similar from one DNA. It is not possible at all. You know, there was a theory recently that homosexuality is genetic. And when I read in the Times of India, I thought, surely, the moment I attend the next lecture on Sunday in IRF, I'll be asked this question. If homosexuality is genetic, how can Allah blame us? Quran speaks against homosexuality. And I said that, see, this is a theory. Wait till it gets established. It's a theory. Don't comment on that. Within the matter of span of this few months, it was proved to be illogical. And the person who propounded this theory that homosexuality is genetic, himself was an homosexual. Therefore, I said, I'm going to give my talk on scientific facts, not on theories and assumptions. Darwin's theory has not been proven. We have not been created from ape. There are hundreds of scientists who speak against that, and Quran speaks against that also. Quran says the first man was Adam, peace be upon him. Inshallah, they'll discover it 100 years afterwards, or maybe 1,000 years afterwards. Today, there is research showing that human beings have been created from one pair. Again, it's just a theory. It supports the Quranic verse that human beings have been created from one pair, male and female. It's just a theory. Therefore, I don't quote that in my talk. Inshallah, it will be established 50 years afterwards or 100 years afterwards. Then we'll know that Quran conciliates with this part. So far, it's not conflicting. It's not conflicting with established science at all. Hope that answers the question.
The next question.
Assalamu alaikum. I'm Abdul Samim. I'm a student. In the Quran, it is stated that the hearts of the unbelievers are sealed. But according to science, it is the brain that thinks and not the heart. Your comment, please.
The brother posed the question that the Quran says that the unbelievers' hearts have been sealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Today, science tells us it's the brain that thinks and not the heart, and I do agree with him. So isn't the Quran unscientific when it says that the heart has been sealed? And I do agree, the Quran says that in several places, including Surah Baqarah, chapter 2, verse number 7, that Allah has sealed the hearts of the kafir people. It says that. The seal has been put on the hearts. If you know the Arabic word used here is qalb. The Arabic word qalb has got two meanings. One is heart, and the other is intelligence. So if you translate correctly, the verse says, Allah has sealed the intelligence of the unbelievers. And it's scientifically proven that intelligence has to be sealed, not the organic heart. But there was a person who once posed me the question, Brother Zakir, I agree with you that qalb means heart as well as intelligence. But one verse in the Quran says, the hearts are behind the breast. Then what do you have to give the answer for that? And he was quoting a verse of the Quran from Surah Hajj, chapter 22, verse number 46, which says that the eyes are not blind. It is the heart which is in the breast which is blind. So Quran says the eyes are not blind. It is the heart which is within the breast which is blind. The science tells us eyes see, heart cannot see. So isn't this verse unscientific? Here the translation has to be heart. It can't be intelligence. So I tell him, I agree with you, the heart has got two translations. But the word used for breast is sadar. Sadar. Sadar also has got two meanings. One is breast and the other is center. You know how we have the head of an institution, we say Sadar of the institution. Like how we have center, if you have been to Pakistan, how in India we have chok. Over there they have centers. Sadar so-and-so in Pakistan, center so-and-so. Sadar also means center. So the correct translation is, the eyes is not which is blind. It is the intelligence which is within the center which is blind. Same, I started my talk by quoting a verse of the Holy Quran from Surah Taha, chapter 20, verse number 25 or 28, which says, Rabbish rahli sadri. Oh my Lord, increase my breast for me. Rabbish rahli sadri wa yassir li amri. Wahlul uqdata min lisani yafqahu qawli. This was a dua made by Musa alayhi salam when he was asked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to go and deliver the message to the people. He asked Allah, oh my Lord, increase my breath for me. See, breast is not the correct translation. What's the breath got to do with the message? It means, oh my Lord, increase my center for me. Rabbi shuhali sadri, vayasirli amri, and make my task easy for me. Wahlul uqdata min lisani yafqahu qawli, and remove the impediment from my speech, so that they will understand me. As you know, Musa alayhi salam was a stammerer. And if you know, whether fortunately or unfortunately, even I happen to be a stammerer. In childhood, I was a stammerer. Therefore, at the beginning of every talk, and even the beginning of this talk, I said, and I made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rabbish rahali sadri. Oh my Lord, increase my center for me. I'm asking help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Increase my center and remove the stuttering in my speech. Even today, when I don't speak on the stage, I yet stutter. It's Allah who helps me out on the stage. Rabbish rahali sadri. Oh my Lord, increase my center for me. Make my task easy for me and remove the barrier from my speech and between me and the audience so that they will understand me. Therefore, scientifically, if you analyze the work of Surah Hajj, chapter 22, verse number 46, it says it is not the eyes which are blind, it is the intelligence which is within the center is blind. Because they are not blind, the unbelievers can see. Seeing they are blind is unscientific. Like the Quran says in Surah Baqarah, chapter 2, verse number 18, it says that deaf, dumb, the blind, they will not return to the path. Summum, bukmun, umyun fahum la yarjiun. The deaf, the dumb, the blind, they will not return to the path. It's not talking about physical deaf people. It's talking about unbelievers who hearing, they cannot hear. Seeing the signs of Allah, they don't accept the Quran. So, Quran is more scientific. It says correctly, they can see. The eyes are not blind. It is the intelligence within the center which is blind.
The next question from my brother on my left.
Assalamu alaikum to everybody who are present here. My name is Kalim Shah. I'm in practicing interior designing in Bombay. Quran have given all the minute details of embryology. Apart from a miracle or a Hazrat Adam alayhi salam, is it not a contradictory that Hazrat Isa alayhi salam is born without a father's sperms? What is the exact scientific reasoning?
The brother posed the question that how can you prove scientifically the miracle of Jesus, peace be upon him, that he was born without a father, without male intervention. Brother, as I said in my talk, a miracle is an unusual event for which human beings cannot give an explanation. It's an unusual event which is attributed to supernatural power, to God Almighty. The miracles which took place in the past, most of them does not give an opportunity to analyze them today, because we can't go back in the past. We can't go back in the past. There are few miracles which give us an opportunity to examine them. Now, all the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who came before Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, they were only sent for their people. Only for their people. And the message was for a limited time period. Therefore, even the miracle was for a limited time period. What miracles they did then satisfied those people. Those miracles, just by saying that Jesus Christ was born without any father, will not satisfy an unbeliever. Why? He can't go back in time and verify. Because all the messengers that came before Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, they were meant only for their time, not for eternity. But Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he is the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is the last and final messenger. He was not only sent for the Muslims or the Arabs, he was sent for the whole of humanity. And his message is still eternity. Therefore, the miracle that he has brought, the Holy Quran, can be analyzed even today. It's a miracle till eternity. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, has done hundreds of miracles, other miracles, which we Muslims believe. But he never emphasized that. We Muslims don't boast of that. We Muslims only boast of this, because we can't prove those miracles scientifically. But this living miracle of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, which was given to him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, can be analyzed by us even today. So previous miracles, time does not allow us to go back in time. If we could go back in time, we could have analyzed how was he born without a father. But yet, brother, I can yet give you a scientific explanation. I can yet give you. Today, science tells us there are certain species which can be born without male intervention. And the best example is the male bee. The male bee is the egg which has not been fertilized by a male. The queen bee, which lays eggs, which doesn't get fertilized by the male, they are born as male. The female bee is the egg which are fertilized by the male. So there are several animals today in this world who are born without fertilization. I do know that this thing takes place in low animals. There's no proof in high animals. Who does it? Science cannot tell us. Allah's mother does it. So when Allah can make this possible to happen in Isa alayhi salam, where it is described in Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verse 45 to 47, it says, Skalat al-Malaikatu ya Maryamu, Inna Allah yubashiruki bikalmatin, Ismahul Masihu, Isa ibn Maryama, Wajjihan fi dunya wal akhirati min al-mukarrabin. That behold, the angel said to Mary, we give you glad tidings of a word from him. His name shall be Christ, son of Mary, who will be held in honor in this world and in the hereafter. And he will be among the companies of those most righteous. Those most righteous. So the verse continues that he will speak to the people in childhood and in maturity, and will be among the people, those who are righteous. So Mary, peace be upon us, how shall I have a son when no man has touched me? The answer is given, فَإِذَا قَضَىٰ أَمْرًا فَإِنَّمَا يَكُولُ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. When Allah decreed the matter, he just said to it, be and it is. I have given you a scientific explanation. When Allah can make it possible in a male, be. It's very much easy for Allah to make it possible even in this, in Isa alayhi salam, for him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to create a Jesus, peace be upon him. Iza qaza amran fa innama yakun lahu kun fayakun. When he decreed the matter, he just said to it, be and it is. For him to create a million people like that, it's just easy. It's a miracle. I'm not telling you Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was born like that, like the male bee. I don't know. I have given you a scientific explanation. When it's possible there, why can Allah make it in the higher animals, the human beings? I hope that answers the question.
Assalamu alaikum, brother Zakir. My name is Sania. I'm a revered Muslim. The question is, in your lecture, you mentioned the scientific facts from the Quran which have been established. Can you mention a few Quranic verses which science has not confirmed?
The sister posed the question that I've mentioned in my talk, the scientific facts which science has already established, which mentioned in the Holy Quran. Can I mention some few points in the Quran which science has not established? For example, the Quran says in Surah Shura, chapter 42, verse number 29, it says, it is Allah who has created the heaven and the earth and put creatures, living creatures throughout them. Quran says there is life besides this earth. Allah has put living creatures throughout the heaven and the earth. There is no scientific evidence established scientific evidence that there is life beside this earth. Recently, they have been sending rockets and spaceships to different planets, different satellites, etc. And now, just a couple of months earlier, we read in the newspapers that they got certain material from Mars, which gives proof that life can be there in Mars. And in, I think, day before yesterday's paper, I read in Times of India, that they have found water in the moon. Maybe a comet crashed, and there's a big crater, and the water has been frozen to ice. So in future, it will be easier to do investigations. We do not have to take waters from planet Earth to moon. Water is already present there. We can use that water, and it will save us a lot of trouble. Science is saying there are high possibilities of life being there besides Earth. But since Quran says, I believe in it, maybe after 1 or 2 years, they may discover there's life besides this Earth, or maybe after 50 years. Today, scientists, they have given various views. How will our Earth end? Some scientists have given a description that the mountains will fall down. Some scientists say the mountains and rocks will become smooth when the Earth is destroyed. Some people say the ocean will swell up. Some people say the universe will go in a black hole. Several. Quran too gives a description about the Day of Judgment. How will our creation end? Many of them match with the theories of science. Theories, not established facts. For example, the Quran says in Surah Al-Ahqaf, chapter 46, verse number 3, it is Allah who has created the heavens and the earth for a limited period of time. And Allah will surely give you indication that this creation will be destroyed, and gives various signs in the Quran. For example, if you read Surah Qiyamah, chapter 75, verse number 8 and 9, it says that the moon will be buried in darkness. The sun and the moon will join together before our world ends. If you read Surah Takwir, chapter 81, verse number 1, 2, 3, and verse number 6, it says that the sun will be folded up, the stars will fall down, the ocean will swell up, the mountain will fall down in utter ruin. Quran says in Surah Infitar, chapter 82, verse number 1, 2, and 3, it says the sky will be cleft asunder, the star will be scattered, the mountain will fall down. Various signs how will the earth end is given. These are scientific points mentioned in the Quran which science hasn't established yet. For example, the Holy Quran also says in Surah Anbiya, chapter 21, verse number 104, that as we created this creation, we will roll up the heavens like a scroll is rolled up. And as we created the early creation, we shall create a new creation. So Quran says there is one more new creation that is going to be created after the world is destroyed. Science doesn't know about that. Quran says the first man on the earth was Adam alayhi salam. Science hasn't discovered that yet. Quran speaks about soul. Science hasn't established that human beings have got soul. The Holy Quran also speaks about jinns, about spirits, about angels. Science hasn't been able to discover that. Quran speaks about life after death. Science hasn't discovered that. Quran speaks about heaven and hell. Science hasn't discovered about that. But you may ask me the question, Mr. Zakir, you have given such a good lecture speaking about scientific facts, and you believe in jinns, you believe in angels, you believe in soul, you believe in life after death. Aren't you illogical? I will say no, I'm not illogical. I have got a logic why I believe. I don't blindly believe in life after death, in the soul, in heaven and hell, in jinns and spirits. I have a logical belief. I base my logical belief saying that suppose there are scientific facts mentioned in the Holy Quran, out of which, say approximately, 80% have been proved to be 100% correct. 80% of the scientific facts mentioned in the Quran have been proved by science till today to be 100% correct. The remaining 20% is ambiguous, unknown. Not even 0.001% have been proved false. Even if one verse is proved false, the Quran is not the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these 20%, I say, goes in the ambiguous slot, unknown. So my logic says, when 80% is 100% correct, the remaining 20% is ambiguous, out of which not even 0.001% has been proved wrong. all are unknown. My logic says when 80% is correct, even those 20% will be inshallah correct. It's not a blind belief, it's a logical belief.
I would like to just make an observation. We have had throughout most of the questioners who have been our Muslim brothers and sisters. What I would suggest is one questioner, the one who's at the mic here, the one at the mic here, and the next one who's at the mic there, after giving them an opportunity, we would rather give an opportunity to non-Muslims to ask questions, and it would be a more interesting session. What I would like to assure the non-Muslims that though you see a huge crowd of thousands of people here, many of them Muslims, I would assure you we have a very sensible crowd and our volunteers are very trained to be on your side, to protect you, to defend you. There is no, you can rest assured, there is no such thing as someone will come up and say, how do you talk like this? I assure you on behalf of the organizers here, you are totally safe to ask any question, even if you consider it very ridiculous. What I've noticed is Muslim brothers and sisters have come up and asked questions who some other non-Muslim or someone might have put them, or they may have read in some scientific book somewhere and they have put it forward. I hope this observation is appreciated and taken in the right vein. So we'll allow the person who's already on the mics, I'll give them opportunities. Those who are behind them, I would request them, if you kindly appreciate our point of view as organizers and cooperate, though you all have been standing in the queue, if you can cooperate, allow the next question on those mics to any brother or sister who's a non-Muslim, give them a preference after that. It would be very kind of you. Thank you. The next question, please.
My name is Mohammed Sadat. I am a chemical engineer in Hindustan Petroleum. In Quran, it is mentioned that it is Allah who decides the characteristics and the personality of a person inside his or her mother's womb. In the field of genetics, this field has advanced so much that nowadays parents can tailor make their children. If they want to have a very bright student, they can have it by just having that genetic code changed. Now, isn't this contradictory with Quran?
The brother posed the question that today genetics field has advanced and it's possible that we can change the genetics of the child that is going to be born. Quran says that Allah is one who shapes, who forms, and I do agree with that. Quran says in several places. So does it not mean it's contradicting the Quran? No, brother, it is not. When it gives the statement, Quran says, without the power of Allah, it is not possible. Without the power of Allah, it is not possible at all. For example, I'll give an example. Quran says in Surah Rahman, chapter 55, verse number 33, that with power and skill, you will be able to penetrate the heavens and the earth, not without the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Means you will penetrate the heavens and the earth, but only with permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So today, because people are going in the heaven, that does not mean the Quran is wrong. Quran says you can do, but with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Without permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's predicting that people will go in outer space, in moon, etc. But if Allah doesn't want, it cannot happen. And you know the incident of Challenger. The Challenger tried to take off. What happened? He tried to challenge Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What happened? Nothing. Even today, we say family planning. Do you know there's no family planning which is perfect? Even if you do tubectomy or vasectomy, if Allah wants, He can yet bring easy conception to that lady, even if she practices permanent method like tubectomy or the husband does vasectomy. Still there are chances, but negligible chances, that the baby can be born. If Allah wishes, no one can stop. You do any family planning method, in genetics also, if they are able to change, it's with Allah's permission. If Allah doesn't want, you cannot change at all. So few people are successful, all aren't successful. Those who are successful are with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those who are not, Allah has not given them permission. Same way, family planning, those who are successful, Allah gives permission. Those who are not successful, Allah doesn't give permission. Hope that answers the question.
Assalamu alaikum, Zakir bhai. I was a Hindu first and I converted into Islam recently. What I would like to ask you a question is this, that in Islam, I mean, in the Hadith, it is written that the Kana Dajjal is going to come very frequently, I mean, very soon. But the main problem is that on this subject, lot of...
We will not, we will allow questions on the topic. That you put your question directly on this topic. See, Zakir can answer on various topics. In fact, I would like to mention that there are videotapes of Dr. Zakir available outside on various topics he has spoken on. But they take 2 to 3 hours to cover up one topic in a proper context and cover up well. Like there are topics he has spoken on, you can have videotapes out on, is the Quran God's word? Women's rights in Islam modernizing or outdated? Press debate on, is religious fundamentalism a stumbling block to the freedom of expression? Quran and modern science, religion in the right perspective? Al-Quran, should it be read with understanding? Similarities between Islam and Christianity? Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the various world scriptures. Islam, medical science and dietary laws. Islam, the universal religions, and many other topics he has spoken. But today is the time for Quran and modern science, conflict and conflict or conciliation only. We will not allow any topic outside this topic frame, because that we require a 3 hours period to do justice to the topic. That's the reason why. I hope you appreciate that. You can put your question if it is related to the topic. Brother, you can put your question if it is related to the topic.
I would like to answer another question regarding this modern science.
Yes, welcome.
A woman who's, it is always, when a woman is carrying a baby in a womb, Islam forbids abortion. But if a woman is facing some kind of a medical problem, if she's anemic, or if she has just delivered a baby recently, in recent months to come, and there's always a threat to her life. Non-Muslims doctors say to abort it, and the Muslim doctors say it is haram. And someone who's a little bit modern has said that if the child is for 40 days in the womb, before 40 days you can abort it, after 40 days it is not possible, you cannot do it under Islamic law. Is that right or is that wrong?
The brother asked a question that is speaking that today scientifically, the doctors want to abort, etc. Why does Quran does not give permission to abort if it's danger to the life of the mother? Quran speaks about abortion in Surah An'am, chapter 6, verse number 151, as well as in Surah Isra, chapter 17, verse number 31. It says, kill not your children for want of sustenance. For it is Allah that will provide sustenance to you and your children. For killing of infants is a major sin. So abortion is haram under normal circumstances. For example, pork is haram. Alcohol is haram. Having dead meat is haram. But same time, the Quran says in 4 different places. In Surah Baqarah chapter 2, verse number 173. In Surah Maidah chapter number 5, verse number 3. In Surah An'am chapter 6, verse number 145. And Surah Nahl chapter 16, verse number 115. It says that if unwillingly, if you disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah is Rahman or Rahim. If under compulsion, if you disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah is Rahman or Rahim. If you are dying of hunger, pork is the only dish that you can have. Pork becomes halal for you. It's perfectly halal, but don't have so much and keep on having after you don't require it. If you are in a jungle, if pork is the only thing that you can find to eat, or in a desert, pork becomes halal for you only for that time. When you come back to the city, it becomes haram. The same way abortion, just because you don't want a child is haram in Islam. It's a major sin. But if it's a danger to the life of the mother, it's totally allowed. Because in Islam, the life of the mother is more precious than the life of the child, which has not come in being on its own. I do know there are certain people who say that after 40 days, it's not allowed. Before 40, it's allowed. Quran is very clear cut on that. If it's a danger to your life, unwillingly, if you disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's totally allowed. So if the doctor say that you have certain heart problem and the labor pains will cause a strain on your heart, the mother will die, you have to abort, you have to go ahead with it. Because in Islam, you cannot sacrifice a greater loss to save a small loss. The life of the mother who's already alive and adult is more important than the child who cannot live on its own. So in these cases, if it's a danger to the life of the mother, it's totally allowed in Islam. If it's not a danger, it's haram. Hope that answers the question.
The next question from the lady side.
Assalamu alaikum, Radha Zakir. My question is, when Quran speaks so much about science, then how come the Muslims are so backward in the field of science?
The sister posed the question that when Quran speaks so much about science, how come the Muslims are backward? Sister, I would mainly blame the media. The media today is in the hands of the Westerners, the Europeans. It's in their hand. They have the satellite, they have the television, they have the CNN, they have the BBC. It's in their hand. The media is in their hand. And whatever you read in your school books and books which you read in college, you'll read there that from 8th to the 12th century, it was the dark ages. Dark for whom? It was dark for the Europeans, not for the world. The Arabs and the Muslims were very much advanced from the 8th to the 12th century. They were very much advanced. The Europeans were backward. Because they were backward, they said it was dark ages for the world. It was not dark for the world, it was dark for the Europeans. With the limited instruments and technology what we had from 8th to 12th century, what discoveries the Muslim scientists made, it's unbelievable. Today, because science is advanced, we're making so many discoveries. There, with the amount of limited facility we had, the amount of discoveries Muslim scientists made, it's unbelievable. For example, I quoted in my talk that Ibn Nafis, he discovered the blood circulation. But in the medical books and the books we read in school, who discovered blood circulation? William Harvey. Everyone knows William Harvey. No one knows about Ibn Nafis. Ibn Nafis spoke about blood circulation 400 years before. The Europeans, they later on picked up the books of the Muslims and rehashed it and said, we discovered it. See, if you see the discovery that Muslims have made, for example, if you know Al-Idrusi, in 1154, he drew the first map of Mediterranean, the geography of the world, first. Mathematics, Muslims were far advanced in mathematics. We introduced the decimal points. Do you know what we call the digits 1, 2, 3? It's called as Arabic numerals. The other ones are called as Roman numerals. Why it's called Arabic numerals? Because the Arabs were the one who discovered it. The decimal point are the Arabic numerals. The person who first proved the Pythagoras theorem, he was Al-Abtusi. We know about the Pythagoras theorem, but we don't know about Al-Abtusi. He said that the square of the hypotenuse was equal to the sum of the opposite two sides of the triangle. Al-Biruni, he was an authority in trigonometry. All these people, they were experts. If you know of Al-Kindi, Al-Kindi, he was a philosopher, a mathematician, an astronomer. When great scientists like Galileo, Newton, etc., they said that all physical laws were absolute, he said that all physical laws are relative. And today we know the theory of relativity is proved by Albert Einstein. No one knows about Al-Kindi. He was the person who basically gave the idea of theory of relativity. Later on, he did more research and talked about theory of relativity. Who knows about the three brothers, Muhammad, Shakir, and Hassan? Who know about them? They told the surface area of the earth from an angle at the Red Sea when people thought the world was flat. Chemistry, the Muslims are far advanced in chemistry. Ibn Ayyan, Jabin Ibn Hayyar, they have Latinized the word Geber. So when we read in our textbook Geber, we think it's an European. It's a Muslim. Jabir Ibn Hayyan. We know Geber. We don't know who's Jabir. He's the person who distilled alcohol. Alcohol comes from the Arabic word Al-Ghul, meaning ghost, evil spirit. Alkali is an Arabic word. He wrote 2,000 different pages only on chemistry. Muhammad Zakaria Razi, he was famous in medicine. He was authority on the field of smallpox and measles. He was the first person to use mercury ointment. He wrote books on children's disease. There are several Muslims, and Ali ibn Abbas, he wrote 20 volumes on medicine. Ali ibn Sina, known as Avicenna. Avicenna, it doesn't sound Muslim. Ali ibn Sina, Muslim. Avicenna, not Muslim. Who got the title of Aristotle of the East. He wrote the book, Kanun,
which was referred as a textbook of medicine till as late as 17th century. Who knows Ibn Zuhur? He was the person after Alexander who did research on parasitology. He described the H mite, the pericarditis, he described the otitis media, he attacked the stomy. Several medical doctors, Al-Zahari. Al-Zahari was a famous dentist as well as surgeon as well as obstetrician. He invented several instruments of surgery, gynecology, as well as dentistry. We all of us know the other thing, but the media is in the hands of the Westerners. The Muslims are far advanced, but I do agree with you. Today, the Muslims are getting backward in science. You know why? The Europeans are being advanced. You know why? The Muslims are becoming backward because we are going away from the Holy Quran. We are going away from the religion. And do you know why the Europeans are getting advanced? They too are going away from the religion. The Europeans are also getting advanced because even they are going away from the religion. The Muslims, we are going backward because they are going away from religion. I would request the Muslim brothers and sisters out here, as well as non-Muslims, they are people reading the Quran. Why don't we read the Quran with understanding? Why don't we ponder over the verses? We have only kept the Quran kissing and giving on top, that's all. The Quran was not meant only to be kissed and kept on top. It should be implemented in your daily life. If you implement the Quran in your daily life, read with understanding, inshallah, again, we will be on top of the world. Hope that answers the question.
Now I would request our volunteers to give opportunity to any non-Muslim brothers and guests we have here at our mics to give them a preference and opportunity, and then our other brothers. Thank you. Can we have your name and designation and your question after that?
Hello.
My brother on the right.
I am K. Mahesh, from lecturer from Sabo Siddiq Polytechnic in the Computer Department. I would like to ask regarding the Muslim marriage system. Why Islam allows more than one woman to be married with a man? I mean, apart from that, why it allows multiple marriages after talaqs? And does it harm, in terms of medical, like AIDS and that type of things? And why Islam suppresses the woman that much and don't give the equal status to the woman? As a recent example of Afghanistan, which had happened, that a woman had been beaten as she was out and doing some work, and she wasn't in the parda.
Brother, what I would request, you ask question on the topic. Dakir has covered another topic of this question. Women's rights in Islam, modernizing or outdated? There is a videotape we have available, women's rights. It covers up, it's a 3-hour lecture. You just put one question, there are hundreds of questions on this topic.
Brief
topic. And he has covered up many of these questions. What do we request? Ask question on the topic.
Why it allows more than one marriages, like 2-3 women, one man? I mean, marry more than one.
No, woman. I excuse me. Can I have your name, please? I didn't.
K. Mahesh. I am K. Mahesh.
Huh? Mahesh. What I would like to clarify is, today the talk is on Quran and modern science. You may ask any question on this topic, not any question outside this topic.
I would request that if the chairperson give me opportunity, since it's a non-Muslim asking a question, if the chairperson gives the opportunity, we will make only this as the first exception.
Okay, we'll allow this, but let's not make it a habit.
Since the person is not ready to leave the mic, he may think that we may not know the answer. Brothers, we have this rule so that all the questions on the topic are covered. As Dr. Muhammad Naik said, these questions, what have been posed earlier, which was rejected, since he was a Muslim, we didn't allow. Since you're a non-Muslim and you're so enthusiastic, but I think the chairperson will not give a second chance to another non-Muslim who breaks the rules.
We'll allow him. Usually when Zakir goes abroad also, we have a session called open question answer session, on the topic or out of the topic. Today it is not like that. Today it's only on the topic.
The brother posed the question that why does Islam allow a man to marry more than one wife? For remaining questions, all your questions answer in that cassette, even this. But since you asked here, I'm just giving the reply. That Quran is the only religious book on the face of the earth which says marry only one. There's no other religious book on the face of the earth, whether you read the Ramayana, the Mahabharata, the Bhagavad Gita, the Bible, no religious book says marry only one except the Holy Quran. The Holy Quran says in Surah Nisa, chapter 4, verse number 3, it says, marry one of your choice in twos, threes, or fours. But if you can't do justice, marry only one. If you can't do justice, marry only one. Otherwise, if you can do justice, Quran has put an upper limit, two, three, or four. Maximum four, not more than that. Previous religions gave permission for a man to marry as many wives as you want. Quran put an upper restriction of maximum four. You know why? Because if you think logically, if you analyze, but it says at the same time, in Surah Nisa chapter 4, verse 129, it is difficult to do justice between your wives. It's difficult. Therefore, do not turn away from them altogether. Marrying more than one wife, you don't get more sawab. You don't get more blessings. There is no hadith saying that if you marry more than one wife, you get more sawab. There's a hadith which says that if you marry, you complete half your deen. Somebody asked me a question at the time, does it mean if I marry twice, I complete my full deen? No, marriage takes you away from promiscuity, from fornication, therefore it is farz. But whether you marry one or two, yet you're only completing half your deen. The reason why Islam gives permission for polygyny, that's the right word, is because if you analyze, men and women are born in equal proportion. But in the pediatric age itself, since the female is the stronger sex medically, if you ask any pediatrician, he'll tell you, the female can fight the germs and disease much better than the male. So more female children live than the male children. There are more deaths in the male children than female children. When you grow up, there are accidents, death due to cigarette smoking, death due to war. More male die than female. War in Afghanistan. Do you know more than a million people died? Mainly they were gents. Whatever it is, whatever you said, more men die than female. If you analyze the statistics, India is one of the few countries in which there is more male than female. You know why? Because of female infanticide. Every day, 3,000 fetuses are being aborted when they identified that they are females. More than 1 million aborted every year in India on being identified they are female. That's the reason. Otherwise, if you see the statistics of America, there are more than 7.8 million females than males in America alone. In New York alone, there is 1 million female more than male. And out of the population of New York, one third are gay. Sodomite, Cormeluth. There are more than 25 million gays in America. That means there are more than 30 million females who can't find husband in America alone. In UK alone, there are 4 million females more than male. In Germany alone, 5 million females more than male. In Russia alone, 7 million females more than male. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone knows there are how many million females more than males in this world. I am asking you a question that suppose my sister or your sister happens to live in America, and suppose everyone agrees with the philosophy that every man should marry one wife, and every man in America marries a woman, still there will be 7.8 million females, and plus, since the gays also don't get married, there will be more than 25 to 30 million females who can't find husbands. If my sister happens to be one of those unfortunate lady who has not been married and the market is saturated, the only option remaining for my sister is to marry a man who already has a wife or become public property.
The next question from a brother on the left.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Adiyar Anwar. Allah subhanallah created everything. Some verses we prepared like this. Why plural is coming?
The brother posed the question that why has the word we used in the Quran for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Is it more than one? Brother, we in Arabic, the two types. One is we for plural, one is royal plural. Royal plural. Like for example, if you know Rajiv Gandhi, how he used to speak, he used to say, hum dekhna chahte hai, hum. That hum was not plural, it was singular. It's a royal plural, it's called. The same way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, some places uses I, some places uses we. The we in Arabic does not indicate plurality. It means royal plural, actually it is singular. So we, when it says we have created you, it means singular Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Quran clearly states in Surah Ikhlas, chapter 112, verse number 1, Qul huwa Allahu ahad. Say he is Allah one and only. Allah is only one, not more than one. Hope that answers the question.
Assalamu alaikum, brothers and sisters. I would like to know whether organ transplant and organ donation are permitted in Islam.
The sister posed a question that is organ transplantation or donation allowed in Islam or not? There's no verse in the Holy Quran directly saying that whether you should give or you should not give. It's silent on that issue. There were various conferences taking place by various ulama throughout the world, including in Malaysia, in Jeddah, in Riyadh, even here, on this issue where organ transplantation is allowed or not. By the consensus of the ulama of the world, today they say that organ transplantation is allowed if you satisfy the three conditions. First is, the organ that are going to give to the person. The person, if he receives the organ, his life will be saved. Only if his life is in danger, and then if he wants the organ, then it's allowed. Point number two, the person donating the organ, he should not do it for economical reasons, not for money. Not for getting 1 lakh rupees or 2 lakh rupees. Third is, after the person donates the organ, it should not cause loss of his life. Today science tells that there are certain organs in the body, for example, the kidney. One kidney is sufficient for a human being to survive and lead a normal life. The second is an additional. So if, suppose my mother, if she has both the kidney failure, and if I donate one kidney, surely Allah will not hold me responsible. So, but naturally, if it doesn't cause a loss to my life, I can't say I want to donate my heart. If my heart is taken out, I'll die. So I can't donate my heart. I can only donate those organs which will not cause loss. Loss to my life. And I should not do it for economical reasons, point number two. And third, it should save the life. This is the consensus of ulamas of the conference that took place in Malaysia, in Riyadh, in Jeddah, in India. In India, the ulamas were reluctant. But now if you ask the Fiqh Academy of India, even they say it should not be done. But if it is used to saving the life as a last resort, you can give your organ as a donation. Hope that answers the question.
The brother on my right.
Good evening, everybody. I'm a student of Sabah Siddiq. My name is Harsh Vaghela. I want to ask a question that after the death of human being, dead body should be burnt out or should be buried?
The brother posed a question that after a human being dies, should his body be burnt or should it be buried? Let's analyze scientifically which is more appropriate. Brother, as I told in my talk, or in the question answer time, I believe, that the elements, the constituents of human beings, is present in lesser or greater quantity in the soil, in the earth. So we are created from earth, we should go back to earth, it's logical. It's more easier for us to go back into the earth, point number one. Point number two is that if we burn a body, there is pollution. There's environmental hazard. Environmental hazard is there. When you bury a body, there's no environmental hazard. In fact, the place where you bury, point number three, the ground and the surrounding ground becomes more fertile. Point number four, it is very cheap to bury. You don't require any money. Earth is freely available. There are graveyards. But to cremate, to burn, you require tons and tons of wood. Therefore, every year, if the statistics, our government goes in loss of millions of rupees because they're burning wood. Loss to environment, environmental problem, hazard, and plus waste of money. If you calculate the amount of people that are dying, amount of people you are burning, it's a loss of money, hazard to the environment. It's much more logical and scientific to bury the body than to burn. Hope that answers the question.
I would, after the next two questions are over, I will allow some questions on slip. I'm told that some ladies would have written questions on slips. They would not like to ask on mic, or there are some other people also. So we'll allow some questions. The questions which have come on slip can be passed on to me after the question. And unless if there is some brother who's a non-Muslim, I've told them they have not had enough opportunity, so that we will make an exception to that. They can ask on the mic, otherwise I read questions from the slip after the next two questions are over.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Khalid and I am a student. It's mentioned in Quran that sun and other planets revolve and rotate in a fixed orbit. And at other place relating to the doomsday, it's mentioned that earth will collide with sun in somewhat a spiral form. When revolution and rotation can, then the phenomenon of collision takes place, how is it possible?
The brother posed the question that it says that the sun and the earth rotate, and some places say the sun and the earth will collide. Some places it says that. But as I told you, there are certain statements in the Quran talking about the signs of the day of judgment. And I myself quoted in Surah Qiyamah, chapter 75, verse 8 and 9, that the sun and the moon will join together. When? On the day of judgment, not today. It's giving you signs of day of judgment. It's not telling you that today it will happen. The name of the surah is Surah Qiyamah, day of resurrection, and gives various signs that the moon will be buried in darkness, the stars will fall down, the ocean will swell up, etc. These are signs of the day of judgment. Has it happened? No. But before the world ends, it will surely happen. Hope that answers the question. Nowhere does the Quran say a normal circumstance will happen.
Excuse me, to be fair to the people who are already at the mics, next 3-4 we'll allow the system what I'm asking, the volunteers told me can allow some people. What I would say, one question I'll ask now on the slip, then on the mic, one on the slip, then on the mic. I think that would be more preferable. For some people, they said they're feeling bad, okay, they stood for some time. So I think the next two or three people can be allowed to stand, the rest, beyond that, the volunteers can just ask them to please be seated. I think that would be more preferable. Thank you. The question on the slip is, it is mentioned in one verse of the Quran that Allah is the Lord of the two east and two west. How can you explain this verse of the Quran scientifically?
The question posed was that the Holy Quran mentions that Allah is the Lord of two east and two west. How can you explain scientifically? What the person is referring to is a verse in the Holy Quran from Surah Rahman, chapter number 55, verse number 17, which says, Rabbul Mashrikani wal Rabbul Maghribani, that Allah is the Lord of two east and two west. The Arabic word used here is, in Arabic, we have two types of plural. One is dual plural, and one is plural more than two. Here, Rabbul Mashrikani is dual plural, that Allah is the Lord of two east and Lord of two west. Let's see what science has to say about that. And we know that the sun rises from the east and it sets in the west. But science tells us today that the sun rises from the due east only on 2 days, exact east. In the other times, if you notice, this rising, the point of rising of the sun keeps on varying. It rises exactly due east only on 2 days, the 2 days of equinox. All the other days, it either rises south or north of east. Similarly, it rises from one extreme of the east in the summer solstice and rises from the other extreme of the east in winter solstice. Similarly, the sun sets in due west only on 2 days, on 2 days of equinox. All the other days, it either sets south or north of due west. It sets in one extreme of west in the summer solstice and sets in the other extreme of west in the winter solstice. So when the Quran says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Lord of two east and two west, it is referring to the two extreme points of east and two extreme points of west. But there's another verse in the Holy Quran, in Surah Ma'arij, chapter number 70, verse number 40, which says that Allah is the Lord of east and west. It is not dual plural, it is plural more than two. Allah is the Lord of east and the Lord of west. Therefore, Allah is the Lord
of all the various points in East. So in short, Allah is the Lord of two extreme points of East, two extreme points of West, and all the points in between in the West, and all the points in between in the East.
Next question from the lady's side, please.
Assalamu alaikum, Brother Zakir. My name is Malika Muhammad Islam. My question is that, what does the Quran mean when it says that Allah sent down iron from the heaven?
The sisters asked the question, what does the Quran mean when it says that Allah has sent down iron from the heaven? The verse the sisters referring to the Holy Quran is in Surah Hadith, chapter 57, which means iron, verse number 25, which says that Allah has sent down iron, in which there is material for war and various benefits for the human beings. The Arabic word used for send down is anzala. It means to send down. Now, anzala can be looked at in two different ways. One way is Allah has sent down, Allah has revealed. So Allah has revealed that in iron there is a lot of use and material for mighty war, as well as benefits for humankind. Allah has revealed this, that in iron there's material for war and various benefits. And we know today that iron is one of the most important metals we know of. From it we get steel. And steel and iron is used for making instruments of war, like weapons, swords, spears, guns, etc. It's even used for making instruments of peace, like bricklayer, instruments of an engineer, instruments of an architect, knife, fork, spoon, etc. So, if you read the first meaning, it says that Allah has revealed that in iron there is various benefits and material for mighty war. The other way, if you take it literally, that iron has been sent down from heaven. This verse was shown to Professor Armstrong. That what do you have to comment on Surah Hadith, chapter 57, verse number 25, he says that iron has been sent down from heaven. So he tells us that it's recently that the scientists have come to know about the formation process of various elements. And they say that the energy required to make one atom of iron, it's so enormous that the energy of the whole solar system is not sufficient. And a calculation was made that energy four times that of the solar system is made to produce one atom of iron. Means the energy of the moon, the stars, the sun, all these energies we take of the planets, etc., of only the planets of the solar system and the sun and the moon, it will not be sufficient to produce one atom of iron. Scientists today tell us that iron is an extraterrestrial metal, which is confirming the Quranic ayat, if you take it literally, that iron has been sent down from the heaven.
The next question from the slip. There was a philosopher in 6th century BC who said that the earth rotates about its own axis and the planets move around the sun. The Quran also gives the indication of a similar scientific fact. Some people allege that the Prophet copied these points from the philosopher. Please comment.
The question posed was that there was a philosopher in 6th century BC who said that the planets and the earth rotate around the sun. So maybe the Prophet copied from the philosopher, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. I do agree that in the 6th century BC, the Pythagoreans, these people, they defended the theory that the earth and the planets, they rotate and they revolved around the sun. But to say that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, copied from them is illogical, because these people failed to realize that these same Pythagoreans, they also defended the theory that the sun was the center of the universe. The sun was fixed. It did not rotate, neither did it revolve. So to say that Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam copied those two points, earth and planets rotate and they revolve, and didn't copy the point which says that the sun was center of universe, the sun was fixed, it did not rotate, it did not revolve, is illogical. I do know that there are various philosophers
whose works of antiquity gives us ideas, and they say several things. But if you analyze the works of philosophers of antiquity, their works is mixed with valid and invalid reasons, invalid and valid ideas. People normally quote the valid ideas, they forget that they even left behind invalid ideas. They were great thinkers. The difference between these philosophers who predicted and the Quran is, these philosophers only thought and predicted, and they made even false statements. The Quran, alhamdulillah, more than 1,000 verses speak about science, and not a single is wrong. The difference is Quran gives a challenge. To say that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam copied from these people and didn't copy the negative point, maybe one or two it's possible, it was fluke. But to say that all the thousands of verses the Quran speaks about science were copied is illogical, because Quran gives a challenge. Afallah is the Brun al Quran. Walau qana min indi ghairillah lawajadu fi ikhtilafan kaseera. In Surah Nisa, chapter 4, verse number 82, do you not consider the Quran with care? Had it been from anyone besides Allah, there would have been many contradictions.
The next question from my brother on the right.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Faisal. How scientifically or logically can you explain that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being omniscient, that is knowing the past, present, future and everything, sent scriptures before the Quran? Why didn't he send the Quran itself?
Brother has a question, that why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not send Quran earlier? Why did he send the other revelations first and then the Quran? It's like you asking me that why didn't you first teach me medicine? Why I had to go to standard 1, standard 2, standard 3 and then do my medicine? You have to go in stage wise. All the previous revelations that came before the Quran, as I mentioned earlier, were sent only for those people and for a particular time period. The Holy Quran is sent for the whole of humankind, and its message is meant till eternity. Therefore, the previous revelation, they had not been preserved. Allah thought it right. He has divine knowledge. He knows when to send the final revelation. Not that he could not send earlier. Like the teacher knows how much to teach to a student. Should not go beyond the level. So Allah thought it fit that the humankind maybe has reached that level where I can reveal the final revelation. Allah knew that maybe previously the time was not right. Therefore, all the previous revelations, none of them have been preserved except the Holy Quran. Because Quran is the last and final revelation, and it will prove itself to be the word of God. It proved itself 1400 years ago, will prove today, and will be able to prove till eternity, inshallah.
The next question from the slip. The Quran says that Allah has made the earth for you as a carpet. This gives an indication that earth is flat, which is contradictory with modern science.
The question posed was, and people are astonished out here, that the Quran says the earth was like a carpet, spread out like a carpet, so doesn't mean it was flat. What the person is referring to is an ayat in the Holy Quran, in Surah Nuh, chapter number 71. Verse number 19 and 20, which does say that we have spread out the earth like a carpet. But it gives the answer in the next verse, in verse number 20, so that you may walk and travel in the spacious path. As I mentioned in my talk, the geology they tell us today, the earth which we live on the surface is hardly 1 to 10 miles, and less than 1% of the total radius of the earth, which is 3,750 miles. The top layer is a solid shell. The deeper layers are hot and fluid and inhospitable for existence of life. Nowhere does the Quran say that the earth is flat. It gives a similitude that we have spread out the earth like a carpet. People normally have a misconception that a carpet can only be spread on a flat surface. It's wrong. A carpet can also be spread on a spherical surface. For example, imagine that there is a big model of the earth, the globe, say about 10 feet in radius, very big. Very well, you can spread a carpet around it, it's possible.
But Quran is scientifically also speaking that besides spreading out, today science tells us that the earth's crust, because when we lay out a carpet, we normally spread out a carpet on the surface which is not comfortable to walk on. Carpet is normally spread out on a surface which is not comfortable to walk on. So science today tells us that if the outer crust was not spread out like a carpet around the spherical earth, we would not be able to live, because the deeper layers are hot and fluid. So when Quran says they have spread out the earth, it is referring to the earth's crust has been spread out like a carpet. And the reason is given, so that you may walk in the spacious path of the Lord. Quran says in other places also that we have made the earth as spacious. Quran says this in Naba, chapter 78, verse number 6, we have made the earth as an expanse. It is referring that the earth we have made as wide. You know why? The answer is given in Surah An-Kabut, chapter 29, verse 56, which says, we have made the earth as a wide expanse for you, so that you will worship me and me alone. So tomorrow you cannot say that the situation where I lived in, maybe Bombay, it was a difficult circumstances. Therefore, I was prevented to do good deeds and I did evil deeds. Allah says the earth is a wide expanse for you. It is spacious. You cannot give the excuse for doing evil deeds because of your circumstances. Therefore, worship Allah and Allah alone. There is no place in the Holy Quran which says the world is flat. In fact, I told in my speech, the Quran says in Surah Luqman, chapter 31, verse 29, and Surah Al-Zumur, chapter 39, verse number 5, that the world is spherical. And specifically, in Surah Naziah, chapter 79, verse number 30, wal ard ba'da zalika dahaha, we have made the earth thereafter egg-shaped, like an ostrich egg, which is exactly geospherical. Hope that answers the question.
Next brother on my left.
Assalamu alaikum. Rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My name is Abdul Subhan. I'm an accountant. It is mentioned in Quran that Allah tabarak ta'ala says, no one can say what is in the stomach of mother, male or female. But on the other hand, science says, or is proving, that male or female. So kindly give your bright light on this question.
The brother posed the question that the Quran says that no one besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can mention what is the sex of the child in the mother's womb. And today science is advanced. We can come to know by ultrasonography, etc., the sex of the child. What the brother is referring to a verse in the Holy Quran from Surah Luqman, chapter 31, verse number 34, which says, only Allah has the knowledge of the hour, of when it's going to rain, what is in the womb of the mother, where will a person die, and what will he earn. The Quran says only Allah knows what is in the womb of the mother. It does not say what is the sex of the child in the mother's womb. I do know there are various translations, especially the Urdu translations. They mention the word sex. The word sex is not there in the Holy Quran. The Arabic verse of Surah Luqman, chapter 31, verse 34, does not say sex. It says no one besides Allah knows what is in the womb. It's only referring to the nature of the child. Whether the child that will be born, will he be good or will he be bad? Boon for society, will he be bane for society? What will he become, a doctor or an engineer? Will he go to heaven or hell? And no scientist with the best technology can decipher that. Nowhere does the Quran say that only Allah knows the sex. It is saying only Allah knows what will be the nature of the child and what will he do. And no scientist with whatever equipment they have can predict this.
The next question from the slip. What does the Quran speak about the possibility of life on other planets or moon, as the scientists are claiming possibility of water on the surface of moon? I think we have covered this in the earlier part of the question answer session. The next question I would put forward, which has come on the slip. We have talked about astronomy. What is the reference towards astrology and effect of the position of stars and planets on human life? The Hindu mythology and belief lays a lot of stress on Janpatri and palmistry. Your comments, please.
Question posed is, the Quran speaks about astronomy. What does the Quran speak about astrology? Like looking at the stars and Janpatri, fortune telling, etc. The Quran says in several places, including Surah Maidah, chapter 5, verse number 90, it says, Ya ayyuhallazina amanu, O you who believe, innamal khamru wal maisru, most certainly intoxicants and gambling,
wal anzabu al aslamu, dedication of stones, divination of arrows, rituals of min amali shaitan. These are Satan's handiwork. Abstain from such handiwork that you may prosper. The Quran says that do not indulge in fortune telling. It doesn't say whether fortune telling can be right or wrong. It says don't indulge in it. And we know there are many people who can look at the palm and predict your future by looking at the stars, and we know most of it is fake. We know most of it is fake. You go to a computer, put your date of birth, and you get the answer. There was a research done by a professor to just show to the people what did he mean. He taught a classroom of 100 students for 7 days. At the end of the 7 days, he said, I have come to know the nature of all the students. I will write each one's nature on a piece of chit and give it to him. And when I say open the chit, open it simultaneously and give your views. So he wrote a sheet of paper and gave to every student what his nature is. And what has he done in the past? What has he done so far? So all the students, they opened the chit. And do you know that more than 90% said that the teacher was 100% correct. The remaining 10% said he was 90% correct. The experiment was the teacher wrote the same thing for all the 100 students. You know, there are certain things, if I tell you, in the next 6 months, something good is going to happen to you. Even if 100 bad things happen, one good thing is going to happen. So it is no prediction. It is just making a flurry of the people. Most of these people who say that we can predict, you know what they say? See, all the other people, who predict future are false. But the one which I go to, he is 100% correct. Everyone says that. And they take them for a ride, just to make money. Quran does not say whether it's right or wrong. Quran says, do not indulge in fortune telling. It does not say, no one can tell about this or that. It says, don't indulge, it will cause you more harm. Hope that answers the question.
We'll allow another four to five questions, after which we would wind up the program. The next question from the slip is by Advocate Abbas Hetalkar. He asks, the world is threatened with the menace of AIDS. It is not known how to deal with it. Does Quran throw any light on its causes and prevention?
The question posed was that we are threatened with AIDS, acquired immunodeficiency syndrome. Does Quran throw any light on that? If you happen to know, that the first international AIDS conference, it took place in our city of Bombay in 1994 in Hotel Opera Towers, first international conference on AIDS. And Dr. Michael Merson, he was the person who headed here from WHO, World Health Organization. At that time, he said there were about 11 million cases of AIDS detected, out of which 1.6 is present in India. And at the end of century, there'll be 40 million cases of AIDS in the world, out of which 11 million will be in India. More than 25% will be in India. And he said that within 5 years' time, the next 5 years, there is doubtful of any cure. No one will know how to cure this. Best is prevention. Prevention is better than cure. And the reason for this aid he gave as, one is homosexuality. Other is heterosexuality, unsafe sex, that adultery. Third is using needles for drugs, blood transfusion, etc. And fourth is associated with alcoholism. If you analyze, Quran throws light on most of these topics. Quran says in Surah Araf, chapter number 7, verse number 80 and 81, that we sent Lut alayhi salam, Prophet Lut, peace be upon him, to the people. And he said to them, do you practice lewdness, which no one has done before? You prefer in lust men over women. You have indeed gone far beyond the limits. Lut alayhi salam says that these people used to practice homosexuality. And you know the story of Sodom and Gomorrah and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends brimstones on them. Homosexuality is prohibited in the Holy Quran. But now we find in the modern world, they have legalized gay marriage. Do you know that? When I was in Canada, it came in front page. Man and man kissing each other, husband, wife. Legalized gay, homosexuality. Legalized. The gays, they take out a procession for their rights. Gay rights. A headquarter San Francisco, etc. One of the reasons homosexuality. Then comes adultery. The Quran says in Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 32, it says that come not close to adultery. It's an evil opening other roads to evil. Come not close to adultery. And do you know, in America, a man has 8 different sexual partners on average before he settles down with one permanent life partner. On average, 8. Some may have 20, some may have 30, some may have 1, some may have 2. On average, 8 sexual partners before they settle down with a permanent wife. Do you know this? It has been legalized there. Quran is against adultery, totally against adultery. And one of the cause of AIDS is prostitution. You know what we medical doctors call them? CSW. You know what is CSW? Commercial sex workers. We give refined words for this. And according to Dr. Gilada in that conference, he said 50% of the commercial sex workers of Bombay had AIDS. By the end of the century, 90% will have it. There is no place for prostitution in Islam. And most of the people going to prostitutes, the report said, were between 15 to 24 years, young people. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 7, chapter number 3, hadith number 4. He said, O young people, whoever has the means to get married, for it will help you to lower your gaze. Marrying early is preferable in Islam. It will prevent adultery. It will prevent promiscuity. It will prevent homosexuality. Therefore, our Prophet said, marriage completes half your deen. Come to the last reason he gave. Associated with tuberculosis, as well as alcoholism. Major people that go to the prostitute, 95% they have alcohol. Alcoholics. Quran says, as I mentioned earlier, in Surah Maida, chapter 5, verse number 90, it says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amun, O you who believe, innamal khamru al maisuru, most certainly intoxicants and gambling, wal anzabu al aslamu, dedication of stones, divination of arrows, rishtum min amali shaitan, these are Satan's handiwork. Fashtanibullah lakum tuflihun, abstain from such handiwork that you may prosper. Today, the medical doctors, they say, don't call them drunkards. I'll call them the disease. Treat them like patients. You know, that's the terminology we use in the new books of medicine. Alcohol is a disease. How you treat a patient of tuberculosis, of cancer, don't blame the alcoholics. Treat them as patients. It's a disease. I tell them that if alcohol is a disease, it's the only disease sold in bottles. It's the only disease advertised in the newspapers, in the magazines, in the radios, as well as the television. Our government has a law that you cannot advertise anything like alcohol. So you know what they do? Backpiper soda. Who drink backpiper soda? It is there. People know it is backpiper whiskey. It's not backpiper soda. I saw an ad, London Pilsner or some other alcohol company. Glass, ad for glass. Any logical person will know it is an ad for that alcohol. So they're taking a government for a ride. These ads are allowed even on the television, you see it. If alcohol is a disease, it is the only disease which gets revenue for the government. It is the only disease which has got licensed outlets. It is the only disease which has got no viral or germ cause. It is the disease which causes violent deaths on the highway. It is the disease which destroys the family. The Quran says it's not a disease. It says, Rishtum min amali shaitan. These are Satan's handiwork. Abstain from this handiwork that you may prosper.
The next question, please.
Assalamu alaikum, brother Jagir Naik. Educated people do not believe the Qiyamah, the last day, which is judged by Allah. obedient of Allah goes to heaven, disobedient, that is sinners, goes to hell.
The brother posed the question that educated people don't believe in Qiyamah, the day of resurrection, and life after death, etc., that the world is going to end, etc. So, how will you prove to them logically or scientifically about Qiyamah, about life after death, etc.? Brother, one way, as I said earlier, that if 80% of the Quran has been proved to be 100% correct and the remaining 20% is ambiguous, my logic says that even this 20% will be correct. That is the answer I gave earlier. There's another way you can prove to these educated people. I'm asking them a simple question. You ask them a question, is robbing good or bad? Robbing, is it good or bad? The brother is saying it is bad. Is raping good or bad? Bad. The brother is saying it is bad. What I ask the question to these educated people who don't believe in Qiyamah, who don't believe in life after death, I tell them, can you give me one logical reason why robbing is bad? Only one. Can you give me a logical reason why it is bad?
People do live in simple way, that is, they do the bad thing.
People will do bad things.
People like to live in simple way, that is what they would like to do the bad things.
I didn't get the answer. Whatever it is, if you ask a person why not to rob, there will be various reasons. That if you rob, it hurts the feeling of the other person. See, I'm telling you, I am a smuggler. Suppose I'm a smuggler. You prove to me why robbing is bad. See, I'm not bothered whether it's harming the other person or not. No one can harm me. If I rob, if I take out 1,000 rupees from the wallet of a man passing by, I can go to Dilidarabar, I can have dinner, I can have lunch, I can go to movie, I can enjoy life. It is good. Why it is bad? Some people say, if you rob someone else, someday someone will rob you. No one can rob me. I am a mafia. I'm a mafia. I have got 1,000 bodyguards, all with AK-47. All with AK-47. No one can harm me. I can harm them. I have got 1,000 bodyguards, all with AK-47. No one can harm my family. My family is guarded. I want to ask the question, you prove to me robbing is bad. One logical reason, not two. Why it is bad, and I will stop it immediately. I am a logical person. I believe in science. As you said, I'm a logical person. I believe in science. You prove to me why it is bad. Some may say that, see, it's against humanity. I said, who wrote this book called Humanity? Who wrote it? I don't believe in it. I'm enjoying life. When I rob 1,000 rupees, when I rob 1 lakh rupees, I can enjoy life, I can buy a new flat, I can go abroad, and no one can harm me because I am a mafia. Some people say, the police will catch you and put you in the jail. I say, I've got the police in my pocket. I've got the ministers in my pocket. And we know that throughout the world, there are various top smugglers who have got the police in their pocket. They have got ministers in their pocket. No one can harm them. Throughout the world, you got examples. I'm saying, I'm such a mafia. You prove to me why it is bad, and I will stop robbing. And this question I posed to thousands of people in audiences, whatever answer they give, it does not satisfy logic and reason. So I tell them, okay, now you become that mafia, and I will try and convince to you why robbing is bad, why raping is bad. So he's happy, okay, now Zakir took me for a ride, now we will take Zakir for a ride. So I tell him, the reason why robbing is bad, maybe you're a mafia, no one can harm you, I agree with you. No one can harm your family. But if you rob, you go against the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and in the hereafter you'll get punishment. In this world, you may have the police in your pocket, you may have the minister in your pocket, but in the hereafter, you will be held responsible. I'm asking you a question that your human law, you talk about a human law. Now, I'm speaking as a Muslim. Now you are the mafia. I'm speaking as a Muslim and convincing you of Qiyamah and life after death. I'm telling you that if you are a mafia and you kill many people, you may get saved in this world, not in the hereafter. I ask a question that suppose there is a smuggler who has killed hundreds of people. Don't you think he requires punishment? He requires, where will he get it? We see many smugglers lead a luxurious life. They have got palaces. They enjoy life and they die a very good death. Some people die a bad death. Some people die a good death. Don't you think they require punishment? Hitler. Do you know Hitler? He Hitler incinerated 6 million Jews. He burnt 6 million Jews alive. Do you know that? Even if you say 6 lakh, I agree with you. You say 6,000, I agree with you. I'm asking the question, if your law catches Hitler, what punishment can you give him? What punishment? Worst you can do is incinerate him. You can burn him. But that will compensate only for one death. What about the other 5,900,999 deaths? But in my logical case, in the year after, Allah will put him in the hell. And Quran says in Surah Nisa, chapter 4, verse 56, as to those who reject our signs, we will put you in hellfire. And as often as your skins are roasted, we shall give you fresh skins. If Allah wants, he can burn Hitler 6 million times. He can even burn Hitler 12 million times. Therefore, without a year after, there will be no morality in this world. So raping is bad. Why? Because if you get saved in this world, you will pay in the year after. Hope that answers the question.
The next question from the lady side.
Assalamu alaikum. Can you please comment on artificial insemination and test tube babies?
The sister posed a question, can I comment on artificial insemination and test tube baby, whether it's allowed or not in Islam? That's what she means. Sister, artificial insemination is of two types. One is homogeneous and the other is heterogeneous. Homogeneous means using the sperm and the ovum of the husband and wife. If suppose the wife or the husband has certain medical problems, and if you know by doing homogeneous artificial insemination, they can give birth to a child, it's perfectly allowed. But heterogeneous artificial insemination, in which you get a sperm from a sperm bank, it's totally haram. How? You have blood bank. Here today, you also have sperm bank. You cannot go to a sperm bank and get a sperm and use it in your wife. That's haram. So homogeneous artificial insemination is allowed, heterogeneous is not allowed. Same way for the test tube baby, whatever. If it's of the husband and wife, it's totally allowed. If it's not of husband and wife, it's not allowed. It's as good as adultery. Hope that answers the question.
I would request the audience for another 3 minutes. You have borne so much of your time with us. Thank you for your patience. Just give us 3 to 4 minutes to complete the program in the proper format. We apologize to the people waiting in the queue. We understand their enthusiasm, but we hope we will indulge their patience. What I would request, if you have any further questions on this subject or any question on Islam and comparative religion, you are most welcome to attend our lectures at the Islamic Research Foundation Auditorium, which are followed by question and answer sessions every Saturday at 2:45 p.m., every Sunday at 10:30 a.m., and every Monday for ladies at 3 p.m., which are usually handled by Dr. Zakir or some other expert on Islam and comparative religion from the Islamic Research Foundation. We thank Almighty Allah for making this evening program possible for all of us here. On behalf of the Islamic Research Foundation, I thank all our esteemed guests of honor, brothers and sisters present here today, for their rapt attention and enthusiasm we have had throughout the program. Believe me, you all have encouraged Dr. Zakir to strive on harder and give better performances. You have. We appreciate and thank all the persons involved in the professional video recording of the program today, mostly from the Star TV network, so that the many millions to whom this program may go over satellite television would be able to appreciate it too. We are especially thankful to the press who's present here today. Again, they have responded very well. We have noticed in the past that the press has given objective reportage to most of our programs that we have had, and not as some of the Muslims have advised us. No, they always write against you all. They have been objective, I would say. Lastly, I would like to congratulate and thank all the many volunteers who have assisted us and supported us in handling such a vast audience. It's not possible without with just one or two people of us. We are the ones whose faces are seen on the stage. Their efforts are there behind all these curtains and chairs. Until we meet again for such regular special programs, inshallah, we hope you would keep in touch with the IRF and its regular programs. We end the program today with a short dua by Ashraf Mohammadi. Brother Ashraf Mohammadi.
ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. O Lord, give us the best in this world and the best in the hereafter, and save us from the torment of hellfire. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. O Lord, accept this service from us, for you are all hearing, all knowing, and forgive us, for you are often forgiving, most merciful. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة. O Lord, let not our hearts deviate after you have guided us, and grant us mercy from you. Ameen, Ya Rabbil Alameen.